Okay, well, thank you all for coming out today. And I only have 45 minutes to make an ass out of myself, and David's got the rest of the day. No, sorry. But what I want to do today is first of all, three things. One, spend a little time talking about population and labor force developments in the state. The basic, you heard the governor talk about, you know, kind of about some population developments, but the basic capacity constraint on an economy to grow is the size of its working age population and the engagement of that working age population in the job market. And in order for firms to grow, in order for incomes to grow, in order for economic prosperity to occur, this has to happen. When you look at a country that had tremendous economic prosperity for several decades over the post-World War II period, and then has entered into this terrible condition of deflation over the last 20 years, that country, of course, is Japan. And a fundamental problem that faces the Japanese society is its inability to get its population to grow. And when your population doesn't grow, what happens to the average age of that population? It goes up, okay? And we see a little bit of this in the United States. When you go to Vermont, you go to Maine, you know, these are very old states, very low levels of labor force participation, so they can't get the income growth, they can't get the job growth that other parts of the country get. So you're starting to see those parts of the country just sort of fall behind. So it's you know, an economy's a little bit like being a shark. You kind of have to keep moving, and if you don't, you can get into trouble pretty quickly. So we're going to start out with this little discussion of population and labor force growth, and there's some very good news in the state in that regard. But there's some things you need to pay attention to. Second thing we're going to do is spend a little time talking about the current employment situation and see if we can find whether or not there are these labor market imbalances. And when I talk about labor market imbalances, I mean labor shortages, but I also mean labor surpluses, okay? And it's very easy to have both of these things occur simultaneously. And over the last three or four years, about a year ago, a little bit longer, the National Governors Association asked me to come to D.C. and give a talk on this labor shortage issue. And they actually had two panels on this. They had one group of panelists who said, yeah, there's tough labor shortages. And then they had the panel that I was on. Which was myself, a professor from the University of Pennsylvania, and the Commissioner of Labor Statistics from D.C., who basically argued there's very little evidence of labor supply problems in the American economy whatsoever. And I went through this evidence very carefully. I laid it all out. And at the end, okay, and I'll tell you, and there is very little evidence of labor supply problems in the American economy. Very little. But at the end of my talk, I said, except in the Dakotas, okay, it's a funny place. There's different stuff going on out there. Okay, and it's actually, and that's not even a fair statement, because what's going on in North Dakota and what's going on in South Dakota are also quite different. So the answer is, while the rest of the country has really struggled, this part of the country has done really, really well. You've really entered into, I would say, for the last, you know, 15 years or so years, you know, this has really been a strong, strong labor market. And so when I was first approached to conduct this study, you know, I what I ended up doing was writing a kind of a long note to myself to kind of say, okay, is there evidence to suggest these kind of conditions exist? And the answer is yes, there is. So second thing is we're going to take a look at what this evidence is and where we see some of these labor supply problems. And then the third thing I want to do is spend a little time talking about where we see growth and where we see change occurring, particularly economic growth, with respect to industries and occupations within the area, within the state, and then talk about what that means with respect to skill requirements and how skill requirements change. And in doing this study, I've used a number of different databases that I won't bore you with, but I also came out here a couple of times, okay? I came and met with individuals from the business community around the state. I was in Brookings. I was probably in 10 or 12 communities. They had me flying all over the place. I didn't know where I was landing. But they had me all over the state, and I also got a chance to meet with a number of your elected officials as well. So I don't pretend that I know everything and all things about the state. There's lots of stuff that you know more about than I do, but there's a few things I think that I know more about than you, and I'm going to tell you what I think they are. Okay. And then the last thing is, well, you know, I try to be humble, but I must be truthful. The other thing I'd just like to say is, if you have questions or comments as we're going through this, please, you know, this is a great-sized room, so just say, just shout it out, just raise your hand, just, you know, when I'm from the East, so you could be as rude as possible and it won't bother me. So please, and I know it will bother you, but feel free to do it anyway. So please just shout out any kind of issues that may come to mind. So the first thing I want to do is talk about population growth in the state. And this just kind of gives a little population timeline, population growth. And this is just the total population, all residents of the state between 1960 through 2013. And when you take a look at what happened during this period of time, this first line is growth in the size of the population in the U.S. Second line is growth in the size of the population of South Dakota. And what you can see is that over between the 40-year period between 1960 and 2000, the pace of growth of population really lagged that of the pace of growth in the United States. Okay? And part of what you had happening, and part of the reason why this occurred is you had more out-migration from the state than you had in-migration. More people left the state than came into the state. And migration is oftentimes jobs generated. There's a very close relationship between job creation and migration across regions of the country. It's not the only thing that matters, but it's an important thing that matters. But then when you start seeing happenings, and you see that beginning in 1990, the pace of population growth really picks up in the state. And this is especially important. You start getting a lot of job growth in the 1990s, and you get it in an unusual area, okay, where most of the rest of the country doesn't get it, and that industry is manufacturing, right? We start getting manufacturing growth in South Dakota in ways that we don't see in other parts of the country. And between 2000, so we get an 8.5% pace of growth relative to 13%. So we close the gap a little bit with the country. Between 2000 and 2010, we close the gap in terms of population growth a little bit more. Again, why is that occurring? Because we're starting now to get net domestic positive migration. I'll show you that in a minute. And then between 2000 and 2010, 2013, the last 3 years, the pace of population growth in South Dakota is about 1.8 times the pace of population growth in the country. So we're getting much more rapid population growth in the state than we have in the past. What that says to an economist is the productive capacity of the state is rising at a greater rate than it is for the country as a whole. So you're positioned for economic growth in ways that other parts of the country are not. Now, remember, economic growth has got to do with both the quantity of labor supply, but also its quality, right? Quality of labor supply matters as well. So the question, another part of the question then is what's the qualitative nature of growth that we're getting in the state? When you look at a population change, what you see is that between 2000 and 2009, pop grew by about 58,000 in the state. And you forgive my PowerPoint, I didn't do a good job in this. Natural increase, about 41,000. So about 70% of all the rises comes from natural increase, which is simply births less deaths, right? That's it, okay? Births less deaths. Then net international migration, so I'll just read that to there, was about 6,500, which means you had about 6,500 more foreign-born individuals move into the state than moved out of the state. Okay, so you're getting net international immigration coming into the state. And sometimes that, and I haven't looked into this, but sometimes that international migration is associated with the state's post-secondary system. Seeing a lot of colleges and universities now attracting foreign students, foreign-born kids coming in on F-1 visa programs, both at the undergraduate, increasingly at the undergraduate, but particularly at the graduate level, particularly in science, engineering, information technology fields. You see lots and lots. So you get it at the PhD level in some of the STEM fields, about 70, 75% of all the kids are foreign-born, right? Which is not necessarily a position we want to be in, but that is in fact the case. And then, but the other thing we see is that we get net domestic migration, which is the net of all the people that leave South Dakota relative to all the people that come into South Dakota is now a positive 6,800. So this goes from being a positive to negative, helps us get population growth. And then we have this final thing called the residual, which is a statistical artifact that I won't explain to you because I don't really understand it myself. And then we take a look at the next period of time, 2010 to 2013, and what you can see is the pace of population growth is much more rapid. Remember, it took us 9 years to get 60,000. It took us 3 years to get 30,000. So the rate of rise in population is increasing a little bit. And our sources of population growth are changing. Okay, natural increase now only accounts for half of the population growth. We're getting a lot more population growth in the state. It comes from net domestic migration. About 11,500 net new residents of the state in the last 3 years came from other states relative to the number of people that left. So what we're seeing is individuals being attracted into the state. Why are they coming here? Why would you come here? Okay, and the answer is, well, a lot of it looks like jobs, that the relative labor market conditions of this part of the country is so far superior to the rest of the country. This just tracks what's happened to the unemployment rate from January 2007, which was a year before the job market fell apart in the country. The job market fell apart right here around January of 2008. At that time, South Dakota had an unemployment rate of 2.6%. Now, how would an economist interpret a 2.6% unemployment rate? Economists have this idea of full employment that's measured in one of two ways, and there's debates about this. One way they measure it is through something called NARU, okay? And those of you that got a lot of white hair in your heads, remember back in 1968, you remember this, sir? And what was, do you know what I'm talking about? But what do you think? NARU jackets, right? Do you remember NARU jackets? Yeah, right? They were the most hideous looking things on earth. And the upshot of this is NARU is a non-accelerating inflation rate of unemployment. So one way we define the full employment unemployment rate is that rate of unemployment at which, if we try and push the unemployment rate down further, the rate of inflation will accelerate, right? Because as you move towards this high level of capacity utilization, what's going to happen to wages? Okay, you all of a sudden, all your labor supply is working, wages are going to start rising, right? So one of the ways we think about full employment is this non-accelerating inflation rate of unemployment. And the debate about this is an interesting one. I won't get into the details, except that when I was a kid, when I was very young, President Kennedy said the full employment rate of unemployment rate was 2%. By the mid-1970s, when we had that hyperinflation, remember, we economists, what we do is if we don't like the number, we just change the definition, and so we raised it up to about 6.5, became NARU. And right now, people talk about NARU as about a 6% unemployment rate. So, you know, this is the argument now with the Federal Reserve. Should we stop all this quantitative easing? Should we start allowing interest rates to rise? Because if we don't, we're pumping out all that money. What's that money potentially going to do? Cause inflation. So there's a lot of pressure, particularly the guy from Philadelphia, the Federal Reserve President from Philadelphia, a lot of pressure now to mitigate or to reduce the amount of monetary easing we have in the economy, which would push up interest rates and make what's very price sensitive to interest rates? Cars and homes, right? And so the concern on the other side is, if we push those interest rates up too soon, what's gonna happen to demand for homes and cars? Gonna get out. So you can see we're kind of on this knife's edge between inflation and deflation. So we're in kind of a tough area in terms of what our monetary policy is going to be in the next year or so, and these monetary authorities, particularly Janet Yellen, has got to kind of figure out how they thread the needle here. The second thing is, though, the second way to think about full employment is called the Beveridge definition of full employment. And the Beveridge definition is much more simple, and so therefore the one I like. And that's the relationship between the number of unemployed workers, so workers that are ready and available to go to work right now, and the number of vacant jobs that employers are ready to put somebody to work with right now. Okay, and so back in 2000, we had an unemployment rate to vacancy rate that was close to 1-to-1. Okay, we were operating our economy at full employment. We had about 1.3 unemployed workers for every vacant job. So this is a very, very close level to full employment. And when you get in that kind of condition, again, you get these structural mismatches, right? So there'd be some occupations and some industries that experience really nasty labor shortages. At the same time, where there'll be workers getting laid off in other sectors of the economy that don't have the proficiencies, or coming out of the education system that don't have the proficiencies to fill those vacant jobs. So you could have high unemployment in parts of the economy and low unemployment in other parts of the economy. And I'm going to show you that's in fact the case in this state, that you really have the unemployment problems you have in the state appear mostly structural in nature. That is a little bit of a skills gap, skills mismatch. When you take a look at what happens when the economy deteriorates, you see that unemployment to vacancy ratio really collapses. We get in the dot-com bubble, and the unemployment to vacancy ratio, the number of unemployed workers skyrockets, the number of vacant jobs falls. So then we get close to 3 unemployed workers for every vacant job. So what that says is, if I solved all the skill shortage problems in the economy, still 2/3 of all the unemployment I have is associated with this just demand deficiency. I just don't have enough jobs to go around. And then we get this recovery between 2003 and late 2007, 2008, and we get the unemployment rate to come down, and as you'd expect, as that unemployment rate comes down, that vacancy rate rises, and we get that unemployment to vacancy ratio down to 1.5. So this is not quite a full employment economy, but it's pretty good, okay? This is a pretty decent recovery. And then, of course, we get that collapse of 2007, 2008, when the Lehman Brothers went away. This triggered a whole set of financial catastrophes. It basically seized up the banking system. No one trusted each other. So out of a scene, out of It's a Wonderful Life, we sort of call in all the loans, right? And as a consequence of this, a friend of mine was Commissioner of Labor up in New Hampshire at the time, and he told me the way he found out about the recession was that he started getting all these phone calls about bounced checks from employers, because they got their credit with their employers were doing fine, they were paying their bills, but they got their line of credit withdrawn from the banks because the banks couldn't borrow money from other banks because they didn't trust the other banks. They didn't know how much crappy assets these other banks were holding, so as a result, they just headed for the hills. And that's kind of, in essence, what happened here. So then when that occurs, what we see is the unemployment rate spikes and the vacancy rate collapses. You know, you go back to December 2000, we got about 5 million vacancies in the American economy. We get down to about 2 million at the trough of the economic recession. So employers really dry up. And remember this, as this vacancy rate goes down, what's happened to the total number of payroll jobs we have in the economy? It falls by 8.7 million jobs. So we throw millions and millions of people out of work, number of job vacancies shrink, and we end up with this unemployment to vacancy ratio of close to 7-to-1 at that time. And then we slowly slug our way out of this. We slowly slug our way out. We get the vacancy number back up to about 4 million. We get the unemployment number down to just over 10 million, around 11 million, something like that. And we get that unemployment to vacancy ratio back to 2.6. So the American economy kind of comes back to that. But when you take a look, and we don't have a vacancy survey in this state, and it would be a useful thing to have one. But when you see these kind of relationships, what I think has happened here is that at the point where our unemployment rate in the state was at 5.3, we did have a lot of excess labor supply. We probably had an unemployment to vacancy ratio in the state of 2-to-1. We probably had 2 unemployed workers for every vacant job. Okay, there were layoffs, there was cutbacks. You lost some manufacturing jobs, especially you lost construction jobs. These people were thrown out of work. The U to V ratio deteriorates pretty badly. But then as we get the recovery, you see that unemployment rate come down. As that occurs, we'd expect that vacancy ratio to go up pretty considerably. And as the Gov mentioned this morning, we probably are pretty close to a 1-to-1 unemployment to vacancy ratio, pretty close to a full employment condition in the state. So what's this mean when we get to this full employment condition? Well, part of the way you get to full employment, it's got to do with, and this is tied back into this idea of population change and labor force change. Part of the way you get to a full employment unemployment rate depends on who's a job seeker. Because the way we calculate the unemployment, okay, we use as the numerator the number of people who are unemployed. So to be unemployed, you have to be jobless, you have to be immediately available to go to work, okay, and you have to have actively looked for a job in the last 4 weeks. Sitting on the internet doesn't count. You've got to contact an employer within the prior 4 weeks, actively engaged in a job market. If you meet these three criteria, we count you as unemployed. It's not connected with unemployment insurance, it's not related to that at all. These are independent household survey measures. And then we calculate something called the labor force. And the labor force are all the people who, during the survey reference week, have a job. They're employed or they're self-employed. Okay, so if you work 1 hour for pay or profit during the survey reference week and you're age 16 or older, we count you as employed. So we take the total number of people who are employed, the total number of people who are unemployed, and we create this group called the labor force, which are people who are actively supplying labor, successfully or maybe unsuccessfully, but they're actively trying to supply labor in the labor market. Okay, so that tells us about what our productive potential is in the state. It tells us what our potential labor supply is. And so we use that number to calculate something called the labor force participation rate. And the labor force participation rate is just calculated like this. So you take a look at that first number up there, it says 67.1 for the US, 73.2 for South Dakota. What's that mean? It means that for every 100 people in the working age population in the state of South Dakota during the average month during 1999, okay, 73 were in the job market, either employed or unemployed. It means that in the US, only 67 were engaged in the job market, either employed or unemployed. So what that tells us is that the rate at which people engaged in the job market in the state of South Dakota back at that time was much higher than the rate of the country as a whole. Now, I could, if I ranked all the states, okay, remember that 67%, that's going to be in pretty much the median, right? That's pretty much going to be in the middle. There's going to be some mean median difference, but not much, okay? So we're going to have states that have labor aggregate labor force participation rates under 60%, okay? What's that say about that state versus a state that has a participation rate of, say, 73? How would you interpret that? Sorry? Fewer true-income households, so income's going to be lower, okay? How else would you interpret it? More retired, so probably an older state. Maine is right there, okay? How else would you interpret? Could be lazier, right? Sometimes firms absolutely interpret the participation rate numbers in that regard. It's oftentimes used as a measure of work ethic. Fair or not, it's oftentimes used as that. What you see happening here is, and remember, labor force participation gets determined by lots of different factors. It's the age, the gender composition of the population, the marital status, presence of children under the age of 18 in the household, presence of children under the age of 3 to 5, although these have gotten a lot less powerful predictors of labor force attachment today than they have been in the past. But all these various things, it varies a lot by different demographic group. But one of the things you see is that in the U.S., the rate of labor force participation falls from 67 down to 63%. So what that does is it reduces, okay, the unemployment rate in the country, because the number of, think about it as baseball, right? It's the number of at-bats you get is going down, right? Your chance of getting a hit depends upon whether you get at-bat. But what we're seeing happen in the U.S. economy is that over the last 5 years, the number of at-bats the average working-age person is getting has gone down, okay? So because you're not at bat, you've withdrawn from the labor force, we don't count you as unemployed. So a big way that we've gotten the national unemployment rate down is by reducing labor force participation. So we've really hidden some of the unemployment problems that we have in the country, and Ed's going to talk about that a little bit later on. We've masked some of these bigger unemployment problems. I don't think we've done that in this state as much. Do you see the labor force attachment did fall in the state? It fell from 73 down to 70. Now, part of the argument is well, you know, as a population gets older, its labor force is going to decline, and every population is getting older. One of the things I should have done was just tell you the data on population change in the state by age, and when you look at the overall population change between the end of last decade, 1999-2003, up to today, and what you see is most of the growth in the working age population is among people 55. And over. You see, 55 is up by about 50,000. 65 is up by about 30,000. This is the baby bust generation, and this is the echo generation of the baby boomers, right? This is my kids, and so you can see big distributions in the age distribution. It's an aging population in the state, but aging at a much less rapid rate than other parts of the country. Many of the states that I deal with, 120-130%. Of the population's growth in those states is among people age 55 and above. So if I got 130% about 55 and above, what it means is pretty much the population below that is falling pretty sharply, right? And so you're fortunate in some of these numbers. Your decreasing baby bust cohort isn't very big, and you've got a kind of a fairly robust 25 to 34 cohort that's sort of saving things a little bit in the state as well. So we see this decline in labor force attachment, but the interesting thing is, and as I mentioned, labor force participation is going to be a function of age. Young people participate in the job market at lower rates. These three bars here represent prime age workers. This is the period of life where we expect everybody to be in a job market. There's 25 to 54, and as you can see, the labor force attachment in the state's quite high. It's around 87 out of 100 are engaged in the job market during 2012-2013. You get in the pre-retirement years, 55 to 64, incidence of disability starts to rise. I won't get into it, but I've been beat up myself the last 6 months, broke a foot, broke an elbow. But the incidence of disability starts to rise a little bit there. And then you get into retirement years and participation falls pretty considerably because there's no upper limit on the age of the size of the working age population. So the population base for 65 and above is everybody who's alive age 65 and above. When you look at, though, was it the aging population that caused the decline in labor force attachment? The bad news is, in the state of South Dakota, no. Okay. Then when we take a look at the data, what we see is is that among the 55 to 64 population in the state, the rate of labor force attachment rose from 70% back in 1999-2000 up to 75% in 2012. So older workers were remaining in the job market at higher rates than they had in the past. And the biggest change, though, is among the I'm reluctant to say this because I'm getting to that age, but among the elderly, right, the 65 and above population, you see their labor force participation rate. I mean, you look at this thing. That's basically a 50% rise. It's a 35% rise in labor force attachment over this period of time. It's a big, big increase in the size of labor force participation. When you look at where we're going to grow in the next decade, I made these labor force projections, and they're in here somewhere. But when you take a look, when you take a look at these labor force projections, what you'll see is that the size of labor force growth is going to be positive in the state. We're going to grow by about labor force, the size of labor force in the next decade. And these are kind of back of the envelope math. This is just my guess as to what's going to happen to the size of the labor force in the state. And when you look at this, what you see is I think your labor force is going to grow by about 56,000, about 13%, which is going to be above average pace of growth. And basically what this is assuming is your pattern of labor force participation isn't going to change very much, and that it's going to change a little but not very much, and that your pattern of net domestic in-migration, positive in-migration, is going to also continue at the pace that it is. And if we assume that, you're going to get pretty robust population growth working at, or labor force growth in the state relative to the rest of the country, but you're going to get a decline in the 16 to 24-year-old population, a modest increase in the prime working age population, and a big increase, bulk of your labor force growth, 80%, is going to come from the 55 and above population group. This is what your future will look like with respect to potential labor supply down the road. And this is really an important thing to engage individuals in the job market. And when you go back and you look at the sources of the age declines in labor force participation, one of the things you see is that we get this sharp decline in 16 to 24-year-old labor force attachments, down about 9% in relative terms. This is not a happy story. And why is that the case? Because in order to be a productive worker, you've got to have this set of human capital proficiencies. And in a shorthand way, I think there's four parts to it. One is a set of abilities, reading, writing, and math skills, okay, cognitive abilities. And cognitive abilities are something that they're not that malleable. You know, you're kind of dealt this hand, and it's hard to change cognitive abilities. I was laughing this morning because, you know, we were talking about the difference between political science people and math people, and there just are these sort of differences. People just have different kinds of abilities. You know, I'm a big baseball fan. I'm guessing you're all Minnesota fans. Is that right? God love you. But to stand in against somebody throwing a 95-mile-an-hour fastball that can jump and then hit that thing 400 feet, you know, there's no one in this room that could dream of doing that. I mean, in fact, my dream would be able to stand in on a 95-mile-an-hour fastball and not bail out, right? And so these are just people that just have these abilities that just, they're super people. They're not, you know, Albert Pujols is, you know, you wonder if he was born on the planet Earth, right? I mean, this guy could just hit a baseball like nobody's business. Or Miggy Cabrera, I mean, these guys just, they just have this ability that's just unbelievable, right? And they develop, and it's not to say it can't be developed, but they just have sort of this ability. Second thing, though, is knowledge. And knowledge is areas of content. So if you're out at one of the state technical schools, this is knowledge would be HVAC or equipment repair or welding, machine trades. If you go to the universities, it's information technology, computer science, it's physics, it's philosophy, right? These are all kind of knowledge areas, and these are areas that you can acquire primarily through schooling, but oftentimes through on-the-job training activities. As the job content of the economy changes, we've shifted the way that we distribute knowledge in the economy. You know, back in my day, on-the-job training, apprenticeship was a much more important way of developing knowledge proficiencies. As the structure of the economy shifted out of goods-producing towards service-producing industries, formal schooling supplanted work-based learning as sort of the basis to acquire human capital. So we shifted, and one of the things that does is it shifts education and training costs out of firms onto households. And as the earnings premiums of college grads have risen relative to high school grads, what that's done is pushed up the demand for post-secondary enrollment completion in the American economy. And I'll just tell you this. Back when I was a kid, I graduated from college in 1975. The earnings advantage for a kid out of college relative to a kid out of high school was 17%. Okay, that's when Richard Friedman at Harvard wrote a book called The Overeducated American. He said, we're putting too many people in college. The economic returns are trivial compared to the other alternatives, particularly in a very strong manufacturing sector back at that time. And basically argued we need to pull people out of the post-secondary system. And he was right for that time. But since then, the size of the earnings premium has risen pretty sharply, not so much because the earnings of college grads have gone up, although they have, but mostly because the earnings of high school grads have gone down, right? They've just really collapsed. They've really fallen apart very, very badly. And so as a result, last time I ran the data for 2012, was the last year I had, that mean size of the earnings advantage for a young person, 20 to 29, with a college degree in the United States, was about 80%. So although there's kind of this argument that, you know, we're not handling the post-secondary system well, that kids are coming out of debt, kids are coming out of school with a lot of debt, and that's undoubtedly true. But the fact is that the size of the earnings premium at the four-year level, at the bachelor's degree level, still maintained across all majors, you know, still is maintained at about 40%. Now, that's not to say there's not a lot of underutilization among college grads. There is, because part of the reason why there's earnings gap maintained is that college grads push down into, when the labor market's soft, college grads push down into high school grad jobs, right? And then the high school grads get pushed out of the job market, so their earnings fall to zero, right? So it's not necessarily that we're always using the knowledge, skills, and abilities we develop while we're in college, and it's important for us to think through this issue. And I'm just going to divert for a second on this. You know, there's a lot of talk today about political science majors. My daughter was a political science major, so this kind of strikes home. But the reason why I bring this up is that it's not our business to be directing kids into major fields of study. Kids should be, and I'm not saying we do a good job in this, I don't think we do, but kids should be selecting major fields of study based on what they like and also what they think they're good at. Okay, this should be the basis that they choose this. We should not be traffic cops. I've had PhD students from China. I know what it's like to see people from an economy where they're traffic copped into a major. It's not what you want to do. We need to be able to get kids to think about it. And what the Gov said is right. We need to get people, we need sort of a transparency about the gains to different kinds of major fields of study. I got a little book about this called College Major Handbook that lays out for all the different fields of study what the economic payoffs are. But the important thing to understand here is when a kid goes to college and gets a degree in civil engineering, says, I'm going to be a civil engineer, that kid's pathway is laid out for them, right? The day you show up, you know exactly what's going to happen to you. You go to SDSU and say, I'm going to be an accounting major. That's all laid out for you, right? The courses you're going to take, somewhere along your junior year, you're going to go out and do an internship and somehow or other and be an auditor at a, you know, do auditing for a local accounting firm. This is all laid out, and then your post-graduation is pretty clear what that pathway is. So you don't really, you have to really work hard in those majors, but the pathway is very clear for you. And what we need to do is when a kid goes into political science, they need to be thinking about, because they don't have that pathway laid out for them, they need to be thinking about, how do I take this political science degree and convert it into an outcome after I graduate? How do I organize my curricular and extracurricular activities so they can generate a positive outcome? Because the political science majors I saw here today actually seem to have done pretty well, but they had to figure that out themselves, okay? And so we, you know, and part of it is when you get into colleges and universities, and I've worked in one for 35 years too, and one of the things is we place too much emphasis on status and prestige. Okay, we like to be haughty. We like to, particularly in the East, we like to be haughty. We like to put our nose up in the air and talk about our breeding. You know, my wife has one good joke, and the joke is, how do you know someone went to Harvard? Okay, and the answer is, because they tell you, okay? And it's absolutely right, you know, and I know you're listening to that accent, and you're saying, oh my goodness, this is driving me crazy. Except when I hear you say root, I got to tell you, it's right up the wallboard there. So the upshot of this is I know I'm diverting a little bit, but it's important for universities to kind of have a broad mix of fields, but also to think about their responsibilities, not just educating youngsters, but also helping them make that transition into the job market. And that's where sometimes I think we fall down, because we're not doing if we made them accountable for the outcome, or at least, you know, thinking about the outcome, then I think up front we do a little bit better job kind of getting them focused and oriented about how they convert a major in sociology, political science, philosophy, and the like into something that, you know, can transition them not into a philosophy job, but into a college labor market job. Because I've written a lot about the difference between kids who graduate from college labor market versus high school labor market. And all the earnings gains the kids get from a college degree come from getting a job, not necessarily in the major field of study, but getting a job in a college labor market occupation, professional, technical, managerial, high-level sales. That's where the gains come from. So you graduate from college with a degree in philosophy, you get a job as a human resource staff worker, you work your way up. These are great occupations, great opportunities. They want someone with solid proficiencies, some insights, understanding of organization, but a lot of the training we get done on the job. These are fields where there's lots of opportunity for these kids, but they need to have a pathway. We need to kind of figure out how to convert those undergraduate degrees into something where there's an economic payoff. Because if we don't, then higher ed, you know, deservedly should be in trouble. That said, I'll also say higher ed and any kind of human capital activity should be viewed as an investment, okay? And one of the hallmarks of an investment is, and every business person in there knows what I'm about to say, a hallmark of an investment is it's always characterized by risk, okay? And what that means is that I'm making a bet because I think I can make a return in the long run, but I don't really know because the way I find out about the long run is the same way everybody else does. It's got to happen to me, right? It's also true for economists when they make projections. But the second thing is that for our youngsters, they're making the same kind of bet. And when you all make your bets and your investment strategies on physical capital or software and the like, you do a lot of due diligence. And I think what the Gov was saying is we need to do a little bit more due diligence with these youngsters when they're making these bets about the nature of post-secondary education that they're going to undertake so they can mitigate some of this risk and raise the chance that they can get access to a college labor market job when they finish their education. Okay. So the next thing I want to go to, because I'm probably, I got 15? 10? Okay. Next thing I want to go, we're going to have a vote on this whether I get 10 or not, right? the vote is 5. So let me just slip down here. As you can see, I got a lot of slides and not a lot of time. So second thing I did is I took data from something called the Current Population Survey, which is where the official unemployment rate comes from. So I took 2 years of this data, okay, and combined all these data files, because I have the individual records for respondents. So I find all the data files from people from South Dakota, and then I can make estimates based on, rather than a monthly estimate, 24-month estimate about unemployment rates in the state by industry and occupation. So I estimated what the unemployment rate was. This is unemployment rates for experienced workers in the labor force across different industries in the state. And these are the low unemployment rate industries that I identified in the state, okay? And these are all industries basically that have unemployment rates of 3% or less, okay? And when you take a look at this, the big surprise, I gotta tell you, are these two blue collar dominated industries, durable goods manufacturing, transportation and warehousing, and also actually I must say the information industry. You know, nationally, a lot of excess labor supply there in durable goods, a lot of excess labor supply in warehousing sets of jobs. But we do not have that condition here. Durable goods manufacturing unemployment rate is 3% in the state. In transportation and warehousing, I used to be a Teamster, so I know the skill requirements on that. Not high. You can see the unemployment rate there is 2.5 versus 6.5. And then the information industry really has two parts to it. One is kind of the old part, which is magazines, newspapers, which, you know, nationally is in pretty big trouble and sort of got a lot of unemployment. If I could tell you in Philadelphia, the Philadelphia Inquirer about 10 years ago sold for about $500 million. It was purchased last year for $50 million and it's now on the block and they're not going to get $50 million for it. So a lot of the old newspapers are in trouble. So there's been a lot of losses there. But the other side of it is the telecommunications industries, more of the technologically associated kind of information distributors have done much better. And so out here, you got a 7% unemployment rate in the country, but out here it's 3. Finance insurance has got low unemployment rates. A big industry out here, big important industry that's recovered a lot over the last few years is the professional science and technical sector of the economy. This area has done really well. Very low unemployment rates in that area. A lot of staffing pattern dominated by engineering, information technology, fields of study. I don't know this as fact, but I'm guessing if we did a follow-up survey of the graduates of Dakota State and SDSU and the School of Mines, that kids coming out of these engineering computer science fields are probably getting multiple job offers, and the starting wage, I'm guessing, for an engineer. A kid coming out of a mechanical engineer is probably high 50s, low 60s. some of the IT majors, maybe even in the 70s, you know, computer science, and probably multiple job offers for those individuals. And, you know, remember, why is that the case? Because it's just supply and demand, okay? And the supply of kids coming out of these programs is just not that great, in part because these programs are really hard, okay? You gotta first of all, have the abilities, but second of all, have the behavioral traits, the discipline to go through these programs. You know, Friday night, you're at the library doing problem sets in those fields of study. They're very rigorous, very demanding. You know, Drexel University is primarily an engineering computer science institution. And you know, I teach in public policy and that sort of stuff. So, you know, they all come to take me for the easy class. But the answer is, these are really demanding fields. And then the other area that's been a really important source of job growth has been the healthcare and social services industry. Unemployment rates there at 2.7% within the state. Areas where we've got a lot of labor surplus, unemployment rates over 5. Construction sector has not bounced back very well. Unemployment rates at 7% in construction versus almost 12 for the country. Non-durable goods. Difference between durable and non-durable is durable goods are goods that are expected to last, depending on how you define it, 1 or more years, 3 or more years. Non-durable goods are things like food processing. You know, New Jersey's got a lot of non-durable goods, right? That's where the cottage cheese and baby food all gets processed, right? So we got a lot of excess labor supply in non-durable manufacturing. Administrative support and waste management, with that really, a lot of that's the temporary help industry. And it's about 13% unemployment rate in the country, about 8 here, very high. Entertainment and recreation, and you expect that. Entertainment, recreation, arts, very high unemployment rate in the area. And then surprisingly, the accommodation of food services, I think this is in part because of high turnover in the occupations in there, we also have pretty high unemployment rates. So what this does is it describes a state characterized by labor market imbalances, right? Some industries characterized by very low unemployment rates, some industries characterized by very high unemployment rates. And then we try to look at it the other way and look at it by occupations. Okay, so we calculate occupational unemployment rates, and you can see again, you know, business, professional and finance, computer and math science, engineering, life and physical sciences, social services, legal services, education training, healthcare practitioners. These are all unemployment rates where, you know, they're overfull unemployment rates, okay? These are unemployment rates where it's gonna be pretty hard to find workers. Now, the thing is that I've studied this for a long time, and when you go out and you talk to employers, they just tend to tell you there's a labor supply problem, okay? It's in employers' interest to always talk about labor supply problems, and, you know, when the unemployment rate, I've been in states with the unemployment rates, you know, well into double digits, and employers say, oh, I can't get skilled labor. And so that generally makes me a skilled labor skeptic. But when I look at these numbers, these are telling me that these are overfull employment unemployment rates. These are very strong labor markets. These are labor markets with a potential for labor supply problems up here pretty substantial, and that these labor supply problems act as a capacity constraint on the firm's ability to grow. Okay, so the question is, how do we see firms adjust? Okay, because if I'm not getting this labor, what am I doing? And part of what you're seeing is stepped up training activities internally by firms. Part of what you're seeing is more automation, 2 minutes, more automation among firms, robotics substituting capital for labor increasingly. And then the third thing is more cooperation with education and training organizations, trying to work with the higher ed system, the two-year system, trying to coax out a little bit more labor supply, a little bit more interest in kind of different kinds of programs to bring people in the state. All of these are sort of labor supply response sets of programs. The high unemployment areas are in protective services, food prep, construction and extraction, and routine production jobs still are characterized by some excess labor supply within the state. And then the last thing on this is that when you look at the educational distribution of unemployment in the state, you know, unsurprising, you're getting growth in one sector of the state, decline in the other sector of the state, and the consequence is you get sort of these structural problems. High school dropout unemployment rate in the state averaged 10%. High school diploma, 5. Some college, 4. You get an associate's degree in the state, you're at full employment. You get a bachelor's degree in the state or a master's degree in the state. You know, these are very, very strong labor markets for kids coming out of college. I'm not saying it's a perfect transition, but relative to the rest of the country, the difference between a 1.5% and 4.5% unemployment rate for kids is gigantic coming out of a bachelor's degree program. Far, far different kind of labor market environment. For those youngsters, and the last thing is let me just take 2 seconds out to talk about where we're getting some growth in the in the state. And in a long poll, the states outperformed the nation pretty substantially. The national employment's grown by only, between 2000 and 2013, national employment's only grown by about 2 or 3%. It's been very, very sluggish. If you look at the economic recession, we lost 8.7 million jobs between December of 2008, December 2007 and February of 2008. The recovery period from since that time, we've gotten back 8.5 million. So we have not even clawed back to where we were 5 years ago. So this is and at the same time, the number of people in the working age population has gone up, right? So this has been a really, really poor economic recovery, both with respect to GDP and with respect to jobs. This has been horrendous. This is really, really bad. And the reason why I say this is economic recessions over the post-World War II period generally have a geography to them. And this is the first recession in my lifetime that I've seen where every state has experienced substantial job loss, even states like South Dakota that generally do pretty well. This has been a very, very difficult economic recession, touching every family, every household in an important way, either through job loss, asset losses, increased dependency. This has been a very, very tough tough downturn. And it's weakened the country economically in important ways, not the least of which is a skyrocketing deficit. And this is going to be, and I'm going to get a little preachy here, this is going to be a big problem down the road. And the way we're going to solve this problem, there's only one way we can solve this deficit problem. Okay, there's only one way, okay? And you know what that way is? All of us have to continue to work, okay? This is the only way we get out of this, okay? We got to work. We got to figure out not only how do we keep all these older workers together, we got to figure out how to get these teens and young adults into the labor force. One of the biggest worries I have for the state is we're getting this decline in labor force attachment and employment rates among teens, okay? This is not good. Why? Well, because I started to say, and I'm going to quit now, so this is, Don's relieved. Okay, but I started to say there's four kind of proficiencies. There's abilities, there's knowledge, there's something called skills, and then there's something called behavioral traits. Okay, and skills refer to kind of cross occupation, ability, you know, knowledge, behavior, communication, things like this. But behavioral traits are more fundamental. Okay, and when I've analyzed this carefully, behavioral trait proficiencies, knowledge varies a lot. Ability levels vary a lot by occupation. As you move up the level of educational attainment with respect to occupation, ability levels rise, right? Knowledge level rise, skill levels rise. But as you move up that occupational hierarchy, behavioral requirements don't change, okay? They stay the same. So I actually wrote this little paper called Building Blocks of Labor Market Success. And what the paper's about is that behavioral traits are the key, that if you don't have behavioral traits, your chances of failure in the job market rise considerably. So what are these behavioral traits? One, self-control. Okay, that you can maintain your you know, you can maintain yourself, that you know you can deal with a customer, you can deal with a coworker, you can take orders from a boss, and you don't get yourself upset. Two, dependability. Okay, that I can depend upon you for the functions and tasks that are associated with your job, including pretty essential things like showing up. Three. Well, but you're running a retail organization and you don't show up, it's a big deal, okay? Or if you're running an engineering occupation and the guy doesn't show up for 3 days, that's a big deal. Just the incidence of that is lower, but it's still a big deal. And so it turns out that early work experience is a way that kids develop these proficiencies. And what we find is that kids work while they're in school, have improved employment and earnings experiences after they graduate into their 20s, okay? They just do much better in the labor market. And we find that for boys, if they work while they're in school, their chances of enrolling and completing a bachelor's degree program rise considerably. So there's big, big economic payoffs to work experience while our kids are in school. It exposes them, and think about it this way. It's the first time in your life that you're going to be dealing with an adult, okay, in an adult way that's not your parent, and be accountable for your behavior. So the character-forming aspects of this work experience are probably pretty important, and something we shouldn't kind of skip over and say, all those other things kids ought to be doing with the teens. This itself is an important set of activities. As you're going down the road and you're thinking about how we're going to, you know, get ourselves organized, I'm going to just tell you, go back to these four issues. One, every kid's got to answer this question. One, how do I develop the behavioral traits that are essential for me to succeed in life? Two, how do I develop the knowledge, the specific knowledge areas, and pick the knowledge area where I'm going to develop some expertise? Because life's less forgiving now than when I was a kid. I could do stupid stuff and get a full-time year-round job that could support a family. I could go into the Teamsters Union, work a summer, and pay my complete private college tuition for that summer job. That's a world that's gone, okay? And so the choices, we're forcing choices down on people at younger ages. We've got to help these kids figure out what kind of knowledge bets they're going to make. We need to do a better job on that. Three, how we're going to go ahead and bolster kids' academic proficiencies around reading, writing, and math. And four, how we're going to go ahead and maintain and encourage older workers, 55 and above, to continue to develop their proficiencies as they stay in labor markets for extended period of time. This, to me, is the challenge for long-term employment earnings and income growth within the state. The state's in really strong position to succeed in this. I hope you make the right choices. Thanks for your attention. Appreciate it.